Brother Aaron's sermon text is Matthew 2:6. And now Bethlehem in the land of Judah art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of these shall come a governor that shall rule my people Israel.
Amen. The paper each Sunday evening says special message. Sometimes that sounds like a prophecy. Sometimes it sounds like a revelation. Tonight it reads like an exhortation. This text is a quotation of the prophet Micah, and it is found in the record of the wise men coming from the east looking for Jesus because they found his star. And they inquired about he that is born, that was born king of the Jews. And this, you know, Herod called for the right people to answer the question, and this text was read. A man needs a ruler. Man needs a good ruler, a powerful ruler. Man needs a saving ruler. In the beginning, God created the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night. In the beginning, he gave man to have dominion, or in other words, to rule over the creation, and he said to subdue it, to rule over it. He established civil government as a rule in the earth, over society and over nations of people. And even in the church, he raises up them, as the Spirit has said, them that have the rule over you. And so this is something that God uses in every aspect of his work. He sets rulers over people and over places and over what he does. Now, people today like to think of themselves as being free and independent and self-sufficient. In fact, the Laodiceans, they just kind of speak for most people, right? They says, we have need of nothing.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
That's a very common mantra today. People think that of themselves. Free moral agents, we have need of nothing. You know, you will be like God was part of the original downfall. And that is still like at the heart and core of the downfall of sinful humanity, is that they think of themselves as being like God, being their own God.
Yeah.
Sounds absurd, but see, that's you. If you brush away all the flowery talk and the societal downfalls and the temptations and snares, that's what you've got when you brush away all the facade. Mm-hmm. People want to be their own God. They want to rule themselves.
Amen.
This continues to be sought after as the holy grail of happiness. I rule over myself.
Yeah.
They even say things like, I want to be my own boss. They really don't know what they're saying, you know, when they say that. But they think they'll be happy when they are their own boss. Or they want to retire early so I can do what I want. You know, these are all different little weeds all growing up in the same, out of the same soil.
Amen.
Amen.
Or, you know, to target the younger generation, they want to get out from underneath their parents, because that's, once they're out from underneath their parents, then all their problems are gone, right? And they'll be happy then when they get out from underneath their parents. Well, see, our culture, It leads out in efforts to cast off authority.
Yeah, that's right.
To cast off all rule. Other cultures aren't like this. There are other cultures that don't suffer from this same malady. And so when other cultures hear about the power of God, the governor that has been sent from heaven, see, it has a it it finds a different place. That kind of message, actually, it actually finds a different kind of soil in that kind of society than it does in ours. Having a ruler over you is not humiliating. It's not demeaning. Having a ruler is not a replacement for your intelligence or creativity. Even though people think this, a ruler, as the Lord sets up a ruler is a provider, not a taker. Yeah,
that's right.
A ruler is a protector, not a threat.
Amen.
Masters in the scripture, masters, we would call them employers or bosses or supervisors. They are instructed to deal with their servants as themselves also having a master in heaven.
Amen.
So even the bosses have a boss.
Amen.
And even the rulers have a ruler.
Amen.
And the husbands, you know, those husbands who love to bear a heavy ruling hand over their wives, they're quick to forget that their head is Christ.
Yes.
And when they do, those husbands who do know it, well, then their fulfillment of their ruling over their wife is appropriate. Because they themselves, see, Christ is their head. And the head over Christ even is God. Christ is he rules with patience and with tenderness. We have all seen what happens in a home when there's no ruling provider. We've all seen what happens in a company when there's no a ruling governor. We've seen what happens in nations when the rule is weak or corrupt. It ends up in riots and political coups and anarchy. See, man needs a ruler. And this is exactly what God has provided in Christ Jesus. Joseph was exalted in Egypt to be a governor. Same word that is used of Jesus. He was exalted to be a governor. In Genesis chapter 42 and chapter 45 uses those very words. He was made a governor. That was the report given to Joseph's father. He's a governor. He is the governor of all the land. Joseph was needed.
Yeah.
His rule, he was needed at this time in the earth. He was made governor because he was needed. There was a famine. There was dire need. And God, he gave a governor. He gave a ruler because of the need that was, see, Joseph might have lost the election in the U.S. When he was the ruler sent from heaven, and if the people could have voted on him, he might not have made office. Joseph was exalted to be a ruler by God. Moses also was made, he was actually made God to Pharaoh. He was made God to Pharaoh. That's what the scripture says. He had power to do good. He had power to deliver. Moses was needed in his generation. The people needed a ruler. There was power against them. They were oppressed. They were captives. They were being put to task. They were being beaten. Their work was harsh, and their requirements were actually unjust. Their quota was upped, and their provision was cut. And the people needed a ruler, and God sent Moses to be a ruler, to be a governor. Nehemiah, he returned to rebuild a wall, and he had to rally the people together to work, because there wasn't in Jerusalem after the people were living in Jerusalem and mostly around Jerusalem after the Babylonian captivity had ended, and they were living in the wreck of the Babylonian captivity.
Right.
They were living in the aftermath of the destruction of the Babylonian captivity. There needed to be a ruler. The wall wasn't rebuilt by common consensus. It was rebuilt by a governor. Nehemiah came back as a governor. He governed the project, and that's what got it done. The people had a mind to work. They were following a governor. They were working under Nehemiah as a ruler to gather the material, and they all were given a portion, and it all came together. All the wall came, it all joined together. Gideon was made a ruler during a time where he had to hide to thresh the wheat.
Yeah.
There was the Midianites were so oppressive. Yeah. It's like they had that would be like eating in the garage, so your enemies don't find you. And David, you see, Gideon was a ruler. He was set up. Now it took some convincing, right, to convince Gideon that you are a ruler, but he was. And David, you know, young David, he was king. He was king before he took a throne. He was king. He did kingly acts before he ever had a throne, or before he was ever recognized, before he ever had the scepter, so to speak. But David just happened to show up at the war camp at the right time. And see, that was an opportunity for his ruling kingship to like shine out.
Yeah, right.
And he delivered Egypt from, or he delivered Israel from the from Goliath that day. Sovereign power today, strangely enough, is often viewed as inherently evil.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's right.
Many people today fear one world government more than they fear God himself. Mm-hmm. Well, there is, in fact, one world government. God has set forth a governor to rule his people.
Amen.
Our democracy is even worse, I believe, than the feet of the king of the dream, you know, the statue that Daniel had to interpret. It was mixed with clay and iron mixed together. Our democracy is like even worse than that. This is not how God administrates the kingdom.
Yeah, right.
Now, as I said, our text in Matthew chapter 2 is the Jewish lawyers reading the answer to him that is born king of the Jews. He's reading it to King Herod because of this question asked by these foreigners who, from the east.
Yeah.
They had come and says, where is he that's born king of the Jews? And you can imagine in this caucus, the Jewish people looking at each other like, what are they talking about? And so they got to come ask somebody that knows the Bible. And so they came in and they read this text from Micah. And they were troubled. Now, I want to point out how strange this is. It was the men from the east were seeking him that was born king of the Jews, and they came to Jerusalem to seek him that was born king of the Jews. They rejoiced when they found him, but the Jews were troubled at this word. Heaven, what's going on here is that heaven was announcing the birth of the Messiah. That had already been promised, it had already been prophesied, but not everyone could get the message. It was being announced. The shepherds, they could hear it, and so they got it. And Joseph and Mary, they could hear it, so they got it. And these wise men of the East, we don't know that much about them, but they're like a testimony of the acceptance of the Gentiles. In him shall the Gentiles trust. And they got the message from the heavenly bodies of light. Isn't that appropriate?
Yeah.
That by looking upward, they saw his star.
Right.
His star. Now I'm willing just to take it for how God said it, that there was a star that testified of his birth. Now people have, you know, if you look this up and read commentaries and things, you can find all kinds of different things said about this star, and I'm not here to say whether they're right or wrong or who's right or wrong, but the scripture says that it was his star.
Yes.
It he made the stars.
Yes,
and
right.
So see, it's not that far of a reach to think that he made this one to testify of his birth. So at the time, in this time in Jerusalem, there were blind eyes that couldn't see the message. They were troubled.
Yeah.
And there were dull ears that just couldn't hear the message. It's like there was some thundering going on, but they couldn't decipher the message. There were carnal minds that just could not submit to this revelation from heaven. Now, revelation from heaven has always been missed by the masses. So this occasion in Jerusalem is nothing new. Noah was the only one that got the message of the flood. Joseph was the only one that understood the coming famine. And Daniel was the only one that caught on to the progression of kingdoms that was revealed to the king in that dream of the statues. The foreigners, the Gentiles, saw the king, the coming of the king of the Jews before the Jews did. The Gentile wise men sought for him that was born king of the Jews, but the Jews didn't seek him that was born king of the Jews. And so we have in this caucus, so to speak, this dialogue between Jews and Gentiles, we have the flesh and the spirit exemplified. Some were rejoicing at his coming, and some were troubled at his coming. And therein we find it's like a shadow of new man and old man, or flesh and spirit, heaven and earth. He came to a people who were prepared for him.
Yeah, that's right.
Think about this. When Herod asked the question, because this issue was brought up, they knew the answer.
Yeah,
They knew the text that was that specified,
yes,
Bethlehem. They were prepared for him. The prophets had promised, the law had testified, the Psalms had sung, and there was a king. King David was a shadow of him,
yeah,
but they were troubled when all these things were being fulfilled.
Yes.
These things ought not to have been this way.
That's right. Yeah.
All the Jews should have been bidding the Gentiles to come. Instead of the Gentiles were coming and seeing and recognizing before the Jews did. See, they also could have, they knew this text in 2 Chronicles 7:18 that says, "There shall not fail thee a man to rule over Israel."
Mm-hmm.
They knew that text.
Yeah.
But they didn't connect it. Mm-hmm. They were troubled.
Yeah.
They said, This is gonna born king.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I thought they appointed kings, right? He was born king.
Yeah, that's right.
He was born king of the Jews. See, so there were pieces being put in place. See, the law, it had like a piece of the puzzle that had been placed by Moses. And then all the prophets, they brought more pieces in. See, Isaiah, he had a piece that he placed in this divine purpose being unfolded. And David in the Psalms and Moses in the Psalms, and they had pieces that they put together. And as time progressed, there were not only more pieces, but they were becoming more defined,
yes,
more saturated, so to speak.
Yeah, yeah.
And there was the divine purpose was emerging, and he was being, the picture was coming forth.
Yeah.
So Jerusalem should have been the first to recognize him. Instead, they were troubled. Jerusalem should have been where he was hailed and lauded and received and loved, all things being right, but it wasn't known for that. But at the same time, there were the Simeons, and there were the Annas. So there was a remnant. He wasn't totally missed, but it said often, particularly in the Gospel of Luke, there was a division among the people because of him. They had to draw sides. You know, today the media uses the word polarizing. You know, that law, that issue is very polarizing, or this person is very polarizing. Now, Jesus was a very polarizing character. There was a division among the people because of him. He would say things like, "I am from above," and shoo, there's a division. So you had to take a side. And here's two polarizing reports about Jesus. His own received him not. And then the other side of the story, the common people heard him gladly. That's what happened. Like through that like summed up his whole life. Here's another polarizing report I kind of added to this one. He wept over Jerusalem, but he didn't weep over Rome. I don't think it said that he wept over any other city besides Jerusalem. Because of what was invested in Jerusalem. See, God had put his name there. And there's a temple there. Jesus even called it, people say today, oh, the building doesn't mean anything. Jesus said of a building, it's my Father's house. And two times, one at the beginning and one at the end of his ministry, he made a cord of whips and cleaned it out. So to some, he came as a promise. To others, he came as an intruder. Mm-hmm. Power, when it's given to men, is eventually corrupted. It's used for personal gain and enjoyment. It's used for evil and harm against others. Powerful men have written a history of violence and war and oppression in our world. But Jesus, the rule that and the power that God has given to Jesus, God has been completely satisfied.
Amen.
By his use,
yes,
of the rule and the power that God has given him. Psalm 22:28 says, he is the governor among the nations. Even though the men he is governing, many deny it. He is the governor among the nations.
Amen.
Jeremiah 30:21 said, their governor shall come from the midst of them. From the midst of them.
That's right.
They still didn't recognize it, but their governor did come from the midst of them. And so what we actually find is that rule thou in the midst of thine enemies. That was fulfilled and is still being fulfilled. He is ruling in the midst of his enemies. Well, we need a ruler because we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers in heavenly places. There is a very large following today of that man who sought Jesus to divide the inheritance with him and his brother. You know, not really. I don't think as much has changed in the world as people like to think. People still come to Jesus with personal projects. And that's what Jesus refused to hear. The people preach a Jesus that can be exploited for whatever your dreams are. Jesus can make your dreams come true.
Yeah.
There are people who wanted to make him king. He already was king, but they wanted to make him king because he multiplied the bread.
Yeah.
See, I think there's a lot of following of that. We want to serve Jesus because, well, Jesus asked the question, did you follow me because you ate of the bread? Jesus has been adulterated, so to speak, into being like a genie in a bottle or a fortune teller or a coach and a motivator or a marriage counselor, a financial advisor, a parental mentor, a personal bellhop, whatever your whims and dreams may require. Like Jesus is the taxi driver and he turns around and asks you, where would you like to go? It sounds absurd, doesn't it?
Yeah.
It is. The heavens do rule.
Amen.
They do. The Lord is not stretching and struggling to maintain his rule over this world.
Amen.
The heavens do rule. And he does whatsoever pleases him in heaven above and on earth beneath. And he even challenges the inhabitants of the earth. Who is going to hinder me? He has such rule that he can lay out his whole plan from the beginning to the end. He can let leak out all the information and nobody can stop it.
Amen.
A demon never argued with Jesus. And this creation, the nature itself, never delayed in its obedience to Jesus of Nazareth. Never did. There's no question in heaven who is the ruler. And there are never any debates under the earth trying to figure out who has the ultimate power. It's only in earth, in the earth among men, that we find debate and denial about who really is ruler. The scriptures are a commentary on the sovereignty of God and the need of man and the patience of the Lord to convince men of both of these issues. This is like a running theme. God laboring to convince men that he is the ruler and that they have need that he can provide. That's like a con- It's like a continual, like the scarlet thread, so to speak, that's running, or one of them. Psalm 62, verse 11, it says, God has spoken once, twice have I heard this, that power belongeth unto God. God is not struggling for power, but struggling to convince men of his power. It's all the difference in the world. Men of rule and power in this world, they struggle to maintain their power. God, the Lord doesn't struggle to maintain his power. The Lord struggles to convince men of his power. The Lord reigneth, Psalm 99. Let the people tremble. It had to be told. See, no man that saw it, any divine character, whether it was the hem of his, you know, his foot coming down on the Mount Sinai, or whether it was Isaiah in the temple seeing the train of the Lord, or whether it was just an angel, no man being confronted with divinity ever had to be told to tremble.
Yeah, that's right.
They did.
Yeah, amen.
But unless there's a firsthand confrontation, men have to be told to tremble. The Lord reigneth, let the earth tremble. He sitteth between the cherubims, let the earth be moved. The Lord is great in Zion, and he is high above the people. Let them praise thy great and terrible name, for it is holy. All earthly kingdoms and all earthly powers, all earthly rulers, all earthly governors and presidents, they all exist to serve this ruler. And they've all been set up. He sets them up and takes them down.
That's right.
See, it looks like, from our perspective, or from man's perspective, it looks like there's a struggle for power, and there's debating, and there's wars, and there's shifting of resources, and, you know, military and money and all this kind of thing. And when it actually, what all is happening is the Lord's raising someone up.
Yes.
We've seen people in our lifetimes that God raised up, and we've seen powerful men who were powerful on a world scale be brought down.
Yeah, that's right.
Is because the heavens do rule.
Yes, amen.
The apparent success of earthly kings to do their own will and pleasure is not in spite of the ruling Jesus. It is allowed by, they are being allowed by Jesus, or even being enabled by Jesus for his purposes.
That's right.
Many times unwittingly. All power is given to him in heaven and on earth, and is being used as the great shepherd of the sheep. Even while he was humbled in this world, the wicked principalities and powers were subject to him. Even while he was humbled. And in fact, he triumphs over them in his cross. To say nothing of his resurrection. He triumphed over them in it. That's his cross.
Yeah.
He triumphed. When he laid his life down, he triumphed.
Amen.
Now, I love the taste of Romans 5. He says, now, if we were reconciled to God by the death of his son, that's where he triumphed. We were reconciled to God by the death of his son. How much more shall we be saved by his life?
Yeah.
Doesn't that taste good?
Yeah.
He triumphed over the ones that we wrestle with. He triumphed over them when he died. When he died, he triumphed over them.
Amen.
Now what shall be said now that he's alive and now that he's exalted? That tastes good. Revelation 19:15 says, out of his mouth comes a sharp two-edged sword, that with it he should smite the nations, and he shall rule them with a rod of iron. That's not a different Jesus. There's one ruling Jesus, and with that rule, he's saving and he's smiting. Same rule. Same Jesus. In fact, the same sword. It's a double-edged sword. So while rulers among men are striving to maintain their power, Jesus in his power is striving to save. He's not striving to maintain his power. Now here's the gospel. This is not a huge transition, you know, to go from this text to go into the gospel. His rule is a rule to save men.
Amen. Yes.
He is a saving ruler.
Amen.
He is a governor to preserve the saints, to keep the feet of the saints, as Hannah had prayed generations ago. He was exalted, Peter said, for to give repentance.
Yes.
He has such power, he can give repentance.
Amen.
If you've repented from your sins, you have evidenced that he is ruler.
Amen.
Everyone that repents of their sin, they are proving that Jesus is on the throne in heaven. He was exalted to give repentance. Just think about how many people repented of their sins before Jesus was exalted. Compared to today, to the time of the gospel. He was exalted to give repentance. All power in heaven and earth has been given unto him to bring many sons unto glory. The word governor, that's one of those rich words. You know, not all words are created equal. The word governor means it has layers of meaning to it. It means to lead or command, but it also means to be chief and to judge, to govern, to rule the nations. You know, Israel never would have come out of Egypt unless they had a governor. Moses was sent to them as a governor. They never would have come out, to say nothing of making it through the Red Sea and then making it through or surviving at least in the wilderness for 40 years and entering finally into the promised land. Brethren, if we could just momentarily see the wickedness that we wrestle against. Just for a moment. Remember the prophet Elijah or Elisha, I never do remember which one. He prayed for his servant. He says, "Lord, open his eyes." And then just for a moment, I presume, he saw all the angels of God that surrounded them. He saw all the powers that were for them. And boy, it changed how he was thinking. He saw everything that was, it didn't appear to all. The prophet saw it. He had to pray for the servant. And in just a moment, he saw all those powers that were for him. Just imagine if in a tangible, in a physical way, we could see the forces that were against us. Well, if after that fleeting moment, if we were still in our right mind, and if we could still think and stand, then we would have a very good grip on a need for a ruling Jesus.
Yeah.
Revelation 12:5 said that a man-child was born to rule all nations. No one can opt out of this rule.
Amen.
No one voluntarily places themselves under, like, he's your Savior, now make him your Lord. That's just, it's just not a right thing to say. The man-child was born to rule all nations. He was born this way, to rule all nations. God has appointed him to rule. He created the world by him and for him, and he was made to rule all nations. If he's able to save to the uttermost because he rules to the uttermost.
Amen.
Revelation 19, verse 16 says that on his vesture and on his thigh he has a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I've found in my own heart and mind and my own thinking that phrase has kind of escaped me. What the Lord has really said when Jesus is the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. It's a very kind of like John 3:16. You know, I think we all suffer from the danger of things just kind of settling into our hearts and minds and ears and not impacting us like they could. Jesus is a King of Kings. Jesus rules rulers.
Amen.
Jesus is a governor of lords.
Yeah.
It's one thing to rule poor people and paupers and people who have no abilities or resources or strength or power. Jesus is a king to kings.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Jesus is a lord over lords.
That's right.
Now there are kings and lords that are for you, and there are kings and lords that are against you.
That's right.
There are kings and lords that are seen, and there are kings and lords that are not seen. There are kings and lords that have flesh and blood, and there are kings and lords that are in heavenly or in high places. Jesus is the king of all of them.
Amen.
And he's the Lord of all of them. We wrestle not against flesh and blood. But against principalities and powers. We wrestle against these principalities and powers. And he rules those whom we wrestle with.
Yeah. Amen.
Romans 15:12 says, there shall be a root of Jesse, and he that shall rise to reign over the Gentiles. In him shall the Gentiles trust.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, for there to be trust, and there's a lot of promises to those who trust. Mm-hmm. They that trust in the Lord. You know, there shall be as Mount Zion. Blessed are they that put their trust in him.
Yeah.
For there to be trust, there's got to be need, and there's got to be power. The one trusting has to have need. There's got to be some danger. There's got to be some liability.
Yeah.
And the one who is trusted has got to have some power and has got to be able to give some provision.
Amen.
The rule of Jesus is purely and only good power.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
It is the only purely good power.
Yeah, that's right.
Amen.
Every employment of his power is righteous. And every exercise of his rule is godly. It's like approved by God. Everything that he's done. Every time Jesus has been given the scepter. Remember, the Father said to the Son, the scepter of thy kingdom is forever.
That's right.
Scepter of righteousness. Every time Jesus raises the scepter,
uh-huh.
God approves.
Amen.
Amen.
Therefore, being by the right hand of God exalted, and having received of the Father the promise of the Holy Ghost, he has shed forth this, which you now see and hear. See, Peter was able to connect to it. What happened in earth is because of what Jesus did in heaven.
Yeah.
God hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name. The things in heaven, things in earth, things under the earth, they all gonna bow to him. Now, those who bow ahead of time get credit for it, but everyone's gonna bow.
Yes.
Every tongue is gonna confess.
Oh, yeah.
There's credit when you do it here.
Yes.
Amen.
But everyone is going to.
Yes.
The scripture says he is head over all things to the church. And just a couple of concluding thoughts here to leave you with. He's head over all things to the church. Now I remember in the past lumping this together with he's head of the church. And I remember I was instructed more perfectly. It says, well, that's not saying the same thing. He's head over all things to the church.
Yeah.
He is head of the church.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
But there's head and then there's head, right?
Yeah. Uh-huh.
He is the head of the church, the body,
yeah.
from whom all the nourishment, you know, and life flows.
Yeah.
But he's head over all things to the church.
Yeah, that's right.
That means he governs in the interest of his church.
Amen.
Jesus, it was said this morning, I believe Sister Melissa capped this off, that he is only in Jesus, he has brothers and sisters and a wife, and he's a father and a brother at the same time. He is actually preparing his own bride.
Yes. Amen.
And he's been given all of this rule and authority and all power in order to prepare his own bride. He's head over all things to the church. Now I want to recommend to you that you read the book of Acts again with this in mind.
Uh-huh.
He's head over all things
yeah.
to the church. Uh-huh. You wonder about prison cells opening of their own and gates,
yeah.
you know, the gates of the city opening.
Uh-huh.
He's head over all things to Peter.
Amen.
And you think about shipwrecks and serpents coming out of a fire and being shaken back in, and you think he's head over all things to the church.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All of the, he's governing with his church in mind.
Yes.
With the interest, with the welfare of his church in mind. So I'll leave you with this exhortation. Kiss the Son lest he be angry with you.
Amen.
And you perish from the way. What do you think that God will have to say to a person that won't trust the one that he trusted?
Yeah.
The Father has committed all power. He's given the hand of the kingdom over to the Son. And the good pleasure of the Lord is prospering in his hand.
Amen.
Now, what do you think that God is going to have to say to a person who wouldn't trust Jesus, whom God trusted? So I commit to you that you trust him and keep a hold of this promise. Blessed are they that put their trust in him.
Amen.